Thank you very much, and thank you very much for placing this topic on the agenda of primarily adult-driven workshop, but I'm thrilled to have a chance to talk. Though I do want to warn you that I probably will end up the talk and go through the talk with more questions than answers, because we currently really have no data. I will very briefly cover the pediatric and adolescent HIV infection, just a general status where we are. I will talk specifically about the use of long-acting, and I'm focusing primarily on long-acting in the prevention of mother-to-child, the vertical transmission, and then for treatment of perinatally infected HIV, and then specifically focusing on adolescents, both from the prevention point of view and treatment point of view. And just to remind ourselves that looking at the global statistics, under age of 15, we still have 1.7 million children living, and we still, despite the success of prevention of mother-to-child transmission, see about 160,000 cases born each year. I also want to remind you that adolescents constitute approximately the same amount, 1.6 million, but adolescents overlap with children. This is a 10 to 19 years old, so statistics overlap. And we keep seeing about 560,000 new cases in adolescents each year. And I also want you to look at one number here as a woman and point out that a lot of women in the world are living with HIV and the majority of them are childbearing age. So all of it is relevant to HIV in pediatrics and adolescent. And more we start focusing on a very special population. It's very hard to study. We just start coming out with estimates in the last year or two. But we start speaking not only about HIV at risk, not only about HIV infected, we start talking about HIV in utero exposed and ART in utero and postpartum exposed. An estimated number is quite big. 1.5 million children worldwide, and this number is most likely to grow. We currently really have very little leverage on knowing the long-term health impact of those dual exposures. So when talking about the perinatal transmission, and a lot of very good points have been raised today, and I try to stay away in the slides from the general unanswered questions about long-acting, but I try to really point your focus, and again, we'll be asking more questions than have an answer since we really don't have data right now. These are the questions that come to mind when you talk about using the preventive for negative women and therapeutic ART for women living with HIV. Will they be accepting long-acting drugs during the pregnancy? This is a big question. I think just examples driven by Lori and all of us today about the community voice and even choices of dolutegravir tell us we really need to know whether something that injectional, implantable, or in any other form will be acceptable to women throughout the pregnancy and breastfeeding period. Changes in pharmacokinetics and dynamics, I'm looking at, say we could spend a whole session talking about the bodily changes that are very significant in terms of the compartmentalization of the drug, concentrations to the child, placenta, also all unanswered questions. How about dosing schedule also to maximize protective effect? We all know that the major transmission happens from mother to child around the time of delivery. Well, if woman is in long acting prior to becoming pregnant, are we going to redose her? How are we going to, if she's in the tail of previous preventive drug, what are we going to do? How are we going to time that the maximal concentrations are there around the time of birth? Effect of a maternal body was just raised even in terms of weight gain, but many other possible considerations. And the pregnancy outcome. So far, the signal was dolutegravir and other instances is good in terms of premature delivery. Well, will it be as good when it is long-acting or injectional? We really don't know. And effect of maternal treatment on fetus and child. I really don't want to spend that much time here except just pointing out to you 1.5 million children are born with these exposures right now. We cannot even track the health outcome in them because frequently a lot of ethical debates are going in pediatrics. Can we even disclose the maternal status? Can it even go on a child's chart if he's healthy and not infected? When you look about treatment, the prevention of perinatal transmission, pediatric treatment in breastfed children, what can we do there? If we know today, we are seeing more transmission, not in pregnancy, not in delivery. We're actually seeing more transmission during the breastfeeding period because women are usually doing a much better job with staying adherent when they represent one biological unit with a child, when it child is inside. Something happens when the child is outside. There is the disconnect, and there is a lot of burden going on to taking care of the child, so we know adherence drops. So what can we do? There are two major considerations right now going forward is a broadly neutralizing antibodies for prevention purpose, and then preventive antiretroviral long-acting. Of course, it would be ideal, instead of struggling and dosing the child with the pellets twice daily, that you need to mix through the 12 steps to be able to give the child a shot and be protected and live with it. However, we do know that during postpartum period, particularly first time of the week, there are very rapid changes in the metabolism and elimination of the drug. There is a very rapid maturation on multiple body systems. How about premature children and rapid growth throughout the first year of life? The effect of maternal ARVs wash out period on the timing and dosing of the drugs in children. If the mother is a long-acting agent, how will it be transmitted to the child? The concentration and the possible long-hanging effect or tail in the child that will affect your choices of the drugs in the child. Can we do lead-on formulations? Do we need to use the same drugs for lead-on formulations? We all know the problem with developing pediatric oral formulations are very expensive, and the market is shrinking, and industry, rightfully so, from business perspective, is not interested in investing. Can we switch them to different drugs? Infant child exposures to maternal drugs during breastfeeding. Thanks God to today, majority of antiretroviral drugs have very little penetration in the breast milk, but in reality, going forward, will it be the case for the drugs that are administered parenterally to the mother, for example? And then finally, dosing volume considerations. As I speak about these issues, I just want to very briefly highlight a couple of slides where people are looking into this issue. One of this is study led by SEA on the dolphin study on dolutegravir in pregnancy, and here you can see the concentrations in the cord blood actually exceeded maternal plasma concentrations, 123%. We already know for raltegravir that if the mother received raltegravir 2 to 24 hours prior to delivery, we are postponing starting the child on raltegravir postpartum prophylaxis by 24, 48 hours. So how is it going to interplay with long-acting? And the breast milk, so far, concentrations are very little, and SEA has been able to show it, and it's quite in line with multiple antiretroviral drugs. Some exciting news coming from Impact Study 1112 is about the use of VRC01. And this is really exciting because these were injections given to newborns. And there were a study that enrolled 10 single dose and multiple 11 dose. And the beauty of the study was really this curve that shows that up to 58 days, you know, you can see concentration is still present there, which really sets the premise of saying the half timeline was about 59 plus minus 8 days and potential maybe for doing only one or two times per year injections for the protective or body broadly neutralized antibodies for the child. However, when talking about long-acting drugs, when the child is already infected, you also need to think about the low coverage that we have, suboptimal adherence, viral suppression rates in children globally are less than 50% on current regimen, and we blame it on NRTIs, but I can tell you adherence in children is very difficult. High HIV mortality. As I mentioned, there are a lot of challenges with development and manufacturing, delivery even, of suitable formulation for children, and currently available neonatal and pediatric ART drugs are challenging. I just came back from Kenya where I was meeting with caregivers about the use of new lopinavir pellets, and they're a fantastic alternative to the very bitter, disgusting syrup, but it takes a lot of dedicated effort by caregivers. Somebody needs to have a pretty well-organized life to do it twice every day. And raltegravir granules take 12 steps and access to clean drinking water to administer. So we do know it's still very challenging. And we also know that we have no data on dual regimens. All these beautiful theories and Sharon laid out today, we don't have data in children. And thanks God, the SMILE Penta 17 study just started enrolling, looking at dolutegravir darunavir combination. But I will tell you, as she told you, it's difficult to convince adult providers to go from triple therapy. It will be twice as difficult to convince pediatric providers because we are very protectant of our patients. And finally, looking at the volumes, here's a table, and I'm sorry for this small print, but if you look at these columns, these are the volumes of the journal vaccines, including combination vaccines we give to children, and the majority of them in volume are 0.5, maximal 0.65 ml for varicella vaccine, but majority of them 0.5 ml. administered to the child, either sub-Q intramuscular. And you know yourself, the majority of the drugs we discuss here, we're talking about 1 to 3 mL per injection. Is it feasible to the child? So volumes will matter for children more than they matter to adults. And harmonization with weight bands will need to happen because all other drugs are administered through weight bands. And finally, pediatric studies need to start promptly. Please let us not go through the stage approach, 12 to 18, 6 to 12, and under. We really need to start enrolling across all weights, bands, and all ages simultaneously once we have a good safety signal from adult studies. Well, needles are good, but nobody wants to see this picture, right? As much as we can talk about better alternative to oral drugs. So what's next? Well, I borrowed this slide from Charlie Flexner, and this is microneedle patch, and you can see here the anatomy of the patch. These needles don't look nearly as big as on this photograph, and that is something that seems to be very feasible, especially if you place it on the area of the skin where it's not accessible to young child. It can stay there, and you can actually remove most of them after an hour, 2 hours after the drug absorption is completed. So they don't need to stay on permanently because we all know children will most likely tear them off at some point. And this is Charlie Flexner's hand. It's courtesy of his. He actually put one of this microneedle patch on his hand, and you can see the beautiful concentration that are hanging there around in the timeline. So there are some signals, and again, I'm just looking into this as a potentially extremely attractive option, particularly for the world of pediatrics. Well, how about adolescents? I'll finish with a few slides, just again asking a lot of questions. I like this slide because it shows the projected, we're not maybe completely on track, but that's what's going to happen with a pediatric infection as we advance mother-to-child transmission prevention and overall. This is what we expect will happen with adults projected to 2020. Again, some of these projections are off, but general trajectory is there. But I want you to look at this line, 15 to 24. You don't see much reduction in the circle size, and that's because the adolescent population is exploding globally. It's just because we are not catching up. With the current rate of transmission that we're observing, that's what we are going to see, unless we drastically change the prevention in adolescents. We will be having the biggest population to think of in the coming 10 years of this age cohort, and particularly for young girls, because if you look at the number of new infections, this is a proportion between young men and young women. I do want to say that for adolescents, we have very little data, but I do want to highlight some potential challenges. Boys usually start maturing physically later than girls, and the boys usually increase body mass, and here's the differences between them. The boys usually increase body mass more because of the lean muscular mass. Well, the girls, unfortunately, for all of us sitting in the room, as age goes on, fat continues to be an issue. It starts in puberty. So will this affect somehow the distribution of any potential injectables or implantables, particularly in the time of these rapid changes between females and males? We just don't know. Access to prevention is extremely poor to PrEP right now in adolescents. 78 countries require parental consent. That means you cannot have access. And only 1/3 of adolescents globally have comprehensive knowledge at all about HIV and prevention. The problem is, and I think it was raised earlier today, I agree, we should, in adolescents, more than any other population, we should get away from the high-risk definition. They are all high-risk, should be treated a priori as a high-risk, and we should not be dwelling on them and asking them very personal, private questions and trying to map them out on the risk category. Now, adherence to oral and topical PrEP, we know, is challenging and very suboptimal in them, and we also know when we do the focus group discussion, multiple studies already published that there are very high desirability for invisible, long-acting, injectable implant PrEP options for them. How about treating the infected adolescents? Well, we know adherence is a major barrier. This is a study on the top I cite where they used Wise Pellets electronic box and compared to self-reporting. You can see how much higher self-report was compared to the Wise Pill assessment. Second is just a snap of the data of the DTG protocol by impact, and it shows you that adherence less than 90% of DTG-based regimen was associated with viral failure. And the third snapshot I just want you wanted to share. I did the study in DC when we looked at the cohort of highly treatment experienced patients who were failing on the previous regimen. We switched them on DTG primarily based, integrase inhibitor based regimen. We switched them with optimized backbone. And you can see that they have everybody over 13 in the line, red line, had much less probability of ever achieving viral suppression on a new INSTI based regimen compared to children younger than 13. So finishing up with questions for adolescents, acceptability studies really need to happen. Will there be a gender differences in PK/PD? We don't know. Adolescents should be included in adult clinical trials or separate trials, and are difficult to retain. I don't want to rose-coat it. There should be real good strategies how to enroll and retain them in study. And for females particularly, it presents an incredible opportunity to combine with long-acting. And I do want to raise the potential for self-management, because adolescents are private people. They're all over the place. They don't like to be coming to clinics. And I think this population will be particularly interesting for self-management, self-injections, or any kind of other approach to PrEP. And finally, before I finish, I just thought I will go ahead and look, and equally as Laura did, search on the PubMed, what can I find about our experiences in pediatric adolescent medicine with long-acting, and this is all I found. For long-acting injectable antipsychotics, which we are using already quite a bit, in the state of Indiana alone in the United States last year, there were 150 prescriptions filled in children less than, and adolescents less than 18 years of age. However, if you look in the literature, we only have 7 reports, and this is a pretty good search, you can see. 3 case reports, 3 series, no controlled trials, 36 patients total. We really don't have good experience and knowledge how they work. And regarding reversible contraception, somebody raised today, I believe Anton said, what is long-acting? Well, actually, in contraception, Depo-Provera shots are not called long-acting. They're every 3 months. They are called short-acting, and this is to the definition of us saying, what are we going to call long-acting? Only implant and IUD is called long-acting. And if you look at the female data, we know it's highly efficacious, and we know when the women start on it, young women, adolescent women, they like it and they stay. However, poor compliance, high discontinuation rates for short-acting. So my question to challenge it, will these injections that we're putting so much trust on right now, will it be a good, flexible option for adolescents? And finally, injectable, in my opinion, they have implantable transcutaneous. They have a potential to revolutionize. And I did not put this word just because of my Russian background, because I believe that the word revolution is needed for adolescent and pediatric HIV. We really are not doing well there. We are not getting where we need to be. We're behind every single target for adolescents and children. We need to change something radically. So that's an opportunity. It's an opportunity also to curb a tremendous amount of pregnancies in teenage girls. But acceptability studies are very important, and I think we really need to think how we do it going forward and not just assume that the modalities we develop for adults will work and will be a good option for the children and adolescents. And these are just a few studies for those of you interested. If you want to look, I listed a few studies. The middle study, impact study, is oral PrEP, but it's in pregnancy. But the top study, 2008, and the bottom study, 2017, I actually, the study is looking already for alternative, some of the alternative long-acting that I discussed with you. And the particular study is already enrolling the cabotegravir long-acting injectable with rilpivirine is already enrolling in the States. I believe we will see some early preliminary data at CROI this year. And I want to thank all the people who helped me to think through this topic and share the slides. Thanks.